The cost of getting that college degree is off the hook. Is it even worth it? And will it help you land your dream job or launch your career? And now that our generation is getting closer to the big 40, it's probably way past time to check our finances. We've got a lot to talk about, so let's get to it. That Wish You Knew Cafe is open. What's up, everyone? I'm Maya Alzane, and joining me on the couch is Christina Jones, Amir Tyson, Letitia Austin, and Philip Fenty. And helping us check in on Facebook and Twitter, our social media master, Adrian Pachotto.
Hey.
Statistics say that ours is the most educated generation in the country, but all that paper is also costing us more than any generation before us. We've got degrees and a whole lot of debt to go with it. Is it even worth it? What do you guys think?
Honestly, in my opinion, like, people always use Bill Gates and all these Steve Jobs as examples, but at the same time, they're tech geniuses. And there's some jobs and professions, like, if you don't have a degree, like, they'll just X you off the list and they won't take you seriously. So I think it varies from person to person. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I agree.
I think also the time that we are now with the internet being so accessible to everybody, and you know, in the palm of your hand, you have the World Wide Web and a whole host of information that you have access to. So, I don't think that it's necessarily necessary, unless it's, you know, in certain fields that require it.
And then you also have these large corporations like Google, who are the saying, you know, you don't even need to have a college degree anymore to work here.
Yeah.
I know I'm in the tech field, and there's a lot of engineers that didn't go to college because since 11 years old or 10 years old, they were writing code. Right. And what was the point?
Yeah, definitely. I'm in the tech field as well. I did IT in the Army, and I do know that once I got into the civilian world, you know, they weren't concerned about degrees as long as you have certifications. So a lot of these jobs are looking for certifications and trades and, you know, popularity, influencers, you know, things like that over degrees nowadays.
So. Also, yeah, experience.
It's one cool thing about the digital age. It's like there are all these different ways to learn, so you don't have to necessarily go to school.
Exactly.
Go to college.
YouTube University.
Online.
So if you have a certain skill set, basically, like, they won't even care if you have a degree or not. They'll be like, okay, I'm gonna overlook that. You have the skills for the job. All right, I'm gonna hire you.
Exactly.
That's like it's different.
If you're proven successful and you know, in a certain skill set that is required for that job,
for
that's beneficial to that company, you know, the schooling aspect is irrelevant. And I know, you know, a lot of people that are going to school, they can't live life until years later because they have, you know, they're under a mountain of debt. Mm-hmm. So their lifestyle, even though they're, you know, they've been in school for years and now it's like, oh, I'm finally done. When does life truly begin for you if, you know, the lump sum of what you're making is going to you know, your debt, and then you have to wait for you to gain that experience, and then, you know, so there's so many contributing factors that, you know, once you get out of school, you don't have any experience, like, on the job experience. You still have to get that. So
also cost of living is extremely high nowadays, like in major cities. So well, I mean, there's so many other things to consider.
Ask you guys a question, because we're all saying, you know, we don't need it. But on the flip side, I have friends who will say that, you know, they go to college and maybe it's not educational, but it's for the network, and they want to invest in the network. So what do you guys think about college being valuable?
I have something to say about that. So I was sort of like destined to go to college. Both my parents, is something they really wanted for me. Their parents didn't plan for them to go, so that's literally all they wanted for me. And I didn't know what I wanted to do. So going back to the practicality thing, you know, luckily I was privileged enough that they paid for it. If they didn't, I don't know what I would do. And it really taught me, because I went to a tiny liberal arts college. So it taught me not what to think, like a trade school where it's like, here's a skill. It taught me how to think, which sounds kind of hippy dippy, but I did get more critical. And I'm a huge fan of that higher education, sort of that old school model of, oh, it's supposed to challenge your mind and open you up to a bigger world. But I mean, for $50,000 a year,
and, the price
you know, this like little intellectual playground that's so unattainable, to a normal, like I wouldn't be able to afford it myself. It's not accessible at all.
Yeah, I agree.
Like a lot of people, like you go to college, like that's why a lot of people join frats and sororities. And even if you don't join that Greek life stuff, like I wasn't a part of Greek life when I was in college, but just the networking of meeting someone in a similar field and they might take you to the next level. So you never know who you meet that might really help you out in the future.
That's a really great point. Yeah. I met Ryan Coogler this summer, like annual celebration for this nonprofit. And I asked him like basically, did he feel film school was worth it or not? And he said the only reason it was is because he met the network of people that he used to shoot his films. Yeah. And you know.
Yeah, it sounds like more and more people are finding traditional education more as a network. So what do you guys think about, you know, the internet? You mentioned the digital age, the internet. Mm-hmm. If that was around when our educational system was created long ago, it probably wouldn't be structured the way it is today.
Oh, absolutely.
So what do you guys think a new world education structure would look like in a digital age? In a digital age, like would everything be online? Would we just, because there's a lot of curriculum online where it's self-paced.
I think it would be more niche, more specialized.
Yeah. Okay.
And I think it would start earlier. Education, like a lot of what I'm hearing in the education conversations lately is how important like 0 through 3 is, like that age range. And so like I think as we go forward, we'll see people specializing in the things that they, you know, focusing on the things that they'll be doing later in life as adults. Younger and younger. Yeah. Like that's my personal.
I think we see a lot of that now with a lot of like young athletes or children, get kids coding and the STEM programs that are in the school system now, really getting kids and thinking about what they want to be when they get older, but not in the sense of, you know, like back like traditionally, like, oh, you can be anything you want to be. It's like, no, you start now and then you could be good at what you decided to be when you were young.
Exactly.
I mean, that's beneficial because like practice makes perfect. So the better you're at it, better you're like at your field or like the niche you want to go into, like you start at a younger age, you're going to be better than someone that started a lot later.
Exactly.
So if you focus on it early, you can get a lot better quicker.
Doesn't
you know?
Necessarily sure. always mean though that you're going to get it because some people just don't got it. Like someone said that earlier today. Sometimes you got it, you don't.
Yeah.
But kind of to piggyback what someone else was saying, I believe that it would influence young people to kind of dive into self-education if we had that in the earlier days, just because I know I don't really believe in institutionalizing, you know, education, because not everybody learns the same way. It's like if you judge a fish on its ability to climb a tree, it's going to grow up thinking that it's stupid.
Everyone,
you know, and I didn't do well in school, but yet you know, I consider myself intelligent, you know? Yeah. So it's like, you don't have to be institutionalized to be educated. You can teach and learn yourself through experiences as well.
Yes.
On your own, like you can look things up, read books, and that can like enhance your intelligence without even going to school.
Exactly, yeah. You know?
Yeah, sure. Now we have these kids, like you were talking about starting early, and they're making more money than all of us together on this couch.
Yeah.
So we've got to take a break, but when we come back, millennials know how to grind, but are we getting paid to pursue our passions? Stay with us. We'll tell you what we wish you knew when we come back. Welcome back to I Wish You Knew. For a lot of millennials, working a 9-to-5 is just a way to pay the bills until we can figure out how to get paid for what we truly love. But is there anything wrong with a steady job that just pays the bills?
I don't think there's anything wrong with it. It's just personal preference. You know, some people have, they need to be told what to do and they're comfortable just being support. You know, and then there are some people that are driven and have passions and they're like, you know what, I'm going to do that. You know, that aligns with my purpose.
Like, I think it varies from person to person because some people, they don't mind a 9-to-5. Like, all right, I'll just do that. But like some people are like budding entrepreneurs. Like I'm starting a Debonair clothing line. You can follow that at Debonair underscore tire on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. But it all depends, you know.
Yeah.
So like it's what you want to do.
I think there is pressure. Increased pressure from Instagram and social media in general, like just like making people feel like they need to be doing all these other things or be at a certain level of success at this age. Because you see so many different people and you have like all these different like, you know, sources of information all the time. I feel like it's like there is kind of like this pressure to think that you need to be at this level at a certain age. Yeah, but like I think, and, you know, it takes you away from that grind. And it's not glamorized, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like that 9-to-5 thing. It's like, it's just kind of, people look down on it almost, like within our generation, I feel.
If you have a dream and you want to make something happen, like a business, it doesn't matter how old you are. If you believe in yourself, this is one life. So you might as well take advantage of that, you know?
I'm with you on that, because for me, it's super simple. It's, are you happy? And that boils down to, some people are happy making $45,000 a year, being, you know, I don't know, the person who knits little teddy bears, and they're like completely happy. And then you have people who are making tons, six figures, who are entrepreneurs, that is glamorified and are completely miserable. So I just say, whatever makes you happy.
Yeah. And I also think it has a lot to do with the region where you live as well too. Some people feel as though they're forced to have a certain job or career in order to live a certain lifestyle, you know, or live comfortably. You know, I know for me, you know, being in an entertainment field, you kind of have to wait later for the income and kind of have to have something on the side as a back burner or as a backup plan, you know. So some people are faced with those kind of dilemmas of trying to find a balance of being who you are, but also thinking logically of what's going to pay the bills. It's catch 22. It's difficult sometimes.
I think progress is like a lot of times based on the Western world's view, value system, and and so like I think like if you travel to a lot of other places in the world, you'll find people just as happy doing different things, like doing things that, you know, people might call 9-to-5s or whatever, but that are just as important.
Yeah. And that's something, Phil, that you and I had talked about yesterday off camera. We were talking about how, especially in such like a capitalist mecca like the United States, how our generation, there are all these articles that have come out about how millennials worship their job, as opposed to, we're less religious, like traditionally religious generation, and how we really worship capitalism. I mean, I'm somebody who's, I'm always gonna criticize capitalism, right. I don't know you guys. But yeah, you too. So it is interesting how we find our fulfillment so much, I know I do, in our careers, in how we're making money. What do you guys think about that? I mean, do you disagree with me?
I want to take this one really quickly because I think it goes back to self-awareness and happiness. Yeah. Because self-awareness is, are you being self-aware? No, maybe you thrive in a capitalist or a kind of, I wouldn't even say society, but just mindset or meritocracy, or you're a little bit more just like, you know, we should be more holistic about how we think about the world. Everybody has their own thing. And I don't, I think it's important not to impose. Like, maybe you have a work-life balance, but another person might actually love, literally, they're obsessed with this one specific thing, and that's just the way they do themselves. So it's like more about like just like self-awareness and letting people do them.
I think Steve Jobs stated this. He was just like, if you don't have a passion and you're not happy and you're just going with the flow, like, oh, I just want to make a lot of money, like, you have to have, if you're passionate every day going to work, like, that's the only way you're going to be successful and get the money like you desire, you envision for yourself. Like, you actually have to have a passion for what you're doing. You can't fake it just because you think you're going to get a lot of money or anything from that. So you actually have to love what you're doing.
What if someone's passion is money? Like, what if someone doesn't actually care what they do? Because I actually know someone that's like that. Like, they just want to make money, so they don't care what they do, who they hurt, how boring the job is, or having a career. They're just money, how many ways you can think of getting money, kind of like what an entrepreneur does in a way, but like using your passions and mixing everything in.
Well, you mentioned hurting people, like, they don't care about that. So I think there's like an ethical line, and some, maybe that person really like
loves it. They don't have
that thing. But they don't have it.
A lot of people don't have that thing at all. Like, no morals, nothing.
I think to go back to your point, in the Western civilization, happiness is associated with the amount of money that you have. And if you go into, if you travel to other countries around the world, you find that they are extremely happy and know exactly what happiness means, and has so much like better values and quality of life, but live off of, you know, pennies.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's really again, it's state of mind.
Makes you, like, so, like, when you come back from those places, yeah. like, and you see how we live, it's like, okay.
I want to go back.
Yeah.
Let me ask you guys a question. Are you guys happy with your work-life balances? Do you have any experiences?
I think it's a constant struggle.
Yeah.
I actually went through this exact thing where when I realized, you know, I wanted to be in the entertainment field, and you have to realize that in that field, the money comes later. So I had to think about how I should make an income while I'm working on my passions and my what I believe is my purpose. And then I realized that I couldn't pay my bills, you know, with a job versus a career. So, you know, sometimes you have to think, okay, do you get a career? Do you get a job? And what is a career? And what is a job? What are the, you know, comparisons of the two? For me, I know that sometimes you just got to balance it, and whatever works for you might not work for everybody else.
Exactly.
Still ahead, when it comes to money, are millennials focused on their finances? We're getting ready to talk about it. We'll be right back. You knew. We've got student loans, credit card debt, housing, and on and on. But are we paying attention to our finances? So guys, are you spending any time planning for your financial future?
No. Dang.
That was like
it's a good question.
To plan for financial futures.
I
feel like we weren't taught.
That's interesting.
We're not taught.
We're not taught in school. So we should be taught.
I feel like there should be mandatory classes on finances.
In high school.
Like math,
and
science.
And who wants to take accounting,
class,
you know, as
right
an elective? Who's going to opt into that? My parents, they always encourage my artistic and entertainment career. But they always were like, try to get that 401k, a pension, retirement. And I'm just like, how am I supposed to do that when most like entertainment or freelance jobs don't have that security.
Yeah.
So how am I supposed to, it's interesting.
Again, like the cost of living is higher.
It's so high.
So, you know, it's those funds that we would be putting away or whatever, it's a lot, it makes it a lot more difficult to think about longevity, is the point.
How do we learn to do that when most of us can't even, most millennials don't even know how to write a check. Let alone plan your financial future. Like basic things like writing checks and.
And most of our money goes loan officers and stuff.
I think there's just a general consensus that our education system hasn't brought that out to us.
Of course.
But we're all also adults here. So do you guys, what do you guys do currently today to like manage your finances?
I try to save half what I earn, and then I'll decide what I'm going to spend with the other half. But at the same time, it could be unrealistic because sometimes you want to spend more. So it's you actually have to be mature and actually think about the future of it and not right now.
Because we're learning as we go.
Yeah. I've been riding my bike and try not to Uber so much. That's my thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, because DC's not even that big. So it's is this sustainable?
I also think that, and I don't want to make this a race thing, but I do believe that a lot of people of color are not taught to invest in themselves. Versus other families and other cultures, they're taught to invest in themselves. They're taught to be your own boss. They're taught to, you know, think outside the box and to question things and not have somebody hold your hand through everything. And I think that more families and especially people of color should learn to invest in yourself. I think that would actually help the community and us economically.
And invest in your homes and hold on to your homes.
Yeah.
Hold on to your real estate.
There's a lot of equity in that.
That is something that needs to be taught. The importance, the value of what we own and versus what we rent.
Owners,
and
not
being
renters.
Being taught to be owners and business owners as well.
Well, who do you think is responsible for that?
Wow,
it's
a good question.
You think after a certain age, you're responsible for it.
Yeah.
I mean, no one's going in a coffin with you, so.
We were talking about the education system, not talking about finance, but at the same time, you said we're adults, so we could lick up things
exactly.
Like financial 101 for dummies, all that stuff. you could research it.
I tell you, I've learned way more by researching and going to find answers and reading books than I have in school in my entire life.
And then at what point do you begin to think about that? Like, okay, at what point do you like, all right, I gotta get serious now?
Something detrimental has to have happened, I believe, in your life for you to be like, okay, what's going on?
You know? I remember, I moved to another state at a very young age, and I remember like a monumental moment in my life was looking in my closet, because I used to be what they call a sneakerhead back in the day, you know, I had every like dope pair of kicks that came out, and but I always worked, and that's just one of my things. And I remember like having that milestone in my life where I felt like, okay, I have to make smarter decisions, so I can't buy sneakers anymore. Or, you know, now crazy. I have
how
to start saving.
How old were you, though?
I was 19.
So I was 18, in eighth 19. Grade. I was right there with you.
So you just
like,
start
maybe
making,
in 10th grade. Maybe in 10th
you start
grade.
Making, yeah. like, little, like, conscious decisions to maybe not go out to eat and just get some, you know, go to the grocery store instead.
Right.
And then save that, you know, because you see, like, a large majority of my money goes to food.
Same.
You know?
Same.
Yeah, but then also investing in assets and understanding what an asset means.
Yeah.
Because even we can save all we want and not go on Uber and not do Uber Eats, even though I pay a lot for convenience. But one thing that I know that because we have the internet and because we have access to a lot of information, and there's plenty of people on Instagram and Facebook giving out free information, being accountable for our finances is really important for millennials, because our finances are really different than our parents. So you were talking about a checkbook. Sure. We're not really even managing checkbooks anymore, right? We have like cards, and I have like I just started even getting my Cash App, Apple Pay.
Yeah.
So it's like a different way to manage. And even like when you're swiping, you don't think about like, you're not like, unless you look at your bank account every day.
Yeah, money's
kind of out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So like it's that whole like shift in mentality that even our parents may or may not, depending on, you know,
online
how they've
banking
adjusted.
Is clutch though.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, I love it. People still write checks.
You know, what else checks. Is clutch?
It's less common though.
Maybe
yeah,
big
people
checks.
Do.
Maybe they're big checks. So,
you know what else is clutch? Rewards on credit cards.
Oh, nice.
That's clutch. And I think that people they underutilize it. Like if you pay all of your bills that you can pay with a credit card and just pay off your credit card right away, then you get the benefits, then you get free stuff that you would otherwise be paying for, and you can travel more, and you can use those points to pay other bills like food or you know, traveling, flights, hotels, all of those things, and that kind of offsets some costs and allow you to save as well. And then also to your point, understanding, you know, how to invest and what's worth investing and when to move your money and when to put it in, you know. So I think that we may be undereducated because we're not seeking out that information, or we're seeing it and we're not questions. Really we're not you're not taking heed to its importance.
Like the shift of education needs to the focus of education needs to shift at this point, and that's like really what is missing in the society is like, okay, we were at a point we were focused on building the society, the infrastructure of the society, and that's where jobs are going, and that's what the education was focused on. But now that we have this infrastructure in place, it's like, how can we teach our kids how to survive within this?
That's
who's
a really
survive
great
in
point, Philip.
America.
It's been a great show. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you again next time on I Wish You Knew.